Good morning. Electric potential is a scalar, not a vector.
Flippin' physics.
In order to understand how useful it is that electric potential is a scalar and not a vector, let's revisit an example from a previous lesson. Let's determine the electric potential caused by a uniformly charged thin ring of charge positive Q with radius lowercase a at point P, which is located on the axis of the ring, a distance lowercase x from the center of the ring. Bobby, please determine that electric potential.
Electric potential from a point charge equals the Coulomb constant times charge divided by R, the distance from the center of the point charge to the location of the electric potential. But this is not a point charge. It is a continuous charge distribution. So we need to break the uniformly charged thin ring of charge positive Q into an infinite number of infinitesimally small charges dQ. That means the electric potential caused by a continuous charge distribution equals the integral of the Coulomb constant over R with respect to charge. The Coulomb constant and R are constant for every charge dQ. Therefore, they can come out from under the integral. The integral of dQ is just Q, the charge in the ring. But R is not one of our known values, so the Pythagorean theorem tells us we can replace R with the square root of the quantity a squared plus x squared, and we have the electric potential at point P caused by the uniformly charged thin ring.
Very nice, Bobby. Billy, can you use the electric potential at point P to determine the electric field at point P?
Of course I can, Mr. P. But how are electric field and electric potential related?
Earlier today, we showed that the electric field in the R direction equals the negative of the derivative of electric potential with respect to the R direction.
Right. Thanks, Bill.
Yeah.
We can substitute in the electric potential at point P, Bobby just arrived, and change it to the X direction because we know the electric field at point P is in the positive X direction. We showed that last time. The Coulomb constant and charge are constant for every value of x, so those can come out from the derivative. And 1 over the square root is the same as an exponent of negative 1 half. We need to use the chain rule to take this derivative. So the derivative of a squared plus x squared to the negative 1 half power with respect to x equals negative 1 half times the quantity a squared plus x squared to the negative 3 halves power. And the derivative of the quantity a squared plus x squared with respect to x equals 2x. So the electric field at point P equals the quantity Coulomb constant times charge of the thin ring times the variable distance x, all divided by the quantity a squared plus x squared to the 3 halves power.
Hold up. Why could we take r out of the integral, but x had to stay in the derivative? I mean, how can x not be constant and yet r is constant?
It all depends on what you are taking the integral or derivative with respect to. The integral is being taken with respect to the charges on the ring, dQ, and every charge dQ on the ring is the same distance r from point P. However, the derivative is being taken with respect to position in the x direction. In other words, x is a variable distance along the x-axis for the derivative.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
Thank you, everybody. Notice that this derivation of the electric field at point P is much easier than deriving the electric field directly like we did in a previous lesson. Therefore, I would recommend you remember that for a continuous charge distribution, you can first determine the electric potential and then the electric field, and that is often easier than solving for the electric field directly. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoy learning with you.